Yes, sure. Yes.
Yeah, so I think a sufficient number of people are here and I think we can start. So yeah, I'm Ravi Kiran and I'm a representative of the Science and Technology Council. Good evening, everyone, and we're delighted to invite and have you all here for the first talk of the Breakthrough Science series. And today we have Dr. Nisha Kannan from School of Biology, Isathirunthapuram. And Dr. Nisha completed her PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research and Bangalore, and a postdoc from Okayama University in Japan. So her research in the lab mainly focuses on the circulation clock mediated metabolism, sleep, memory, and like the genetical and neural basis of the underlying circadian clock. So today we are very delighted to have her here. And just to mention, she is also a Wellcome Trust TBT Alliance Fellow and also a member of the Executive Committee member of the Indian Society for Chronobiology. So welcome, ma'am, and welcome everyone for the talk. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi, for the introduction. Let me share the screen first. Can all of you see my slides?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. Once again, thanks, Ravi, for the introduction and for the invitation to speak here today about the importance of sleep. I would like to start with a question. On an average, how many hours do you sleep? Any of you can answer. Six to
Yeah.
seven hours. Okay. Yeah. So if we consider a large population, on an average, we do sleep 7 hours, 7 to 8 hours, right? And do you think sleep is important or is it a waste of time?
Important.
It's important.
The title suggests it's important.
Yes, right. And how many days you can remain sleep deprived? 2 days, 3 days, or more than that? Is there anyone who can remain sleep deprived even beyond 4 days? I don't hear an answer. So I assume that there is no one who can remain sleep deprived even beyond 4 days. That indicates the importance of sleep. Right? So when we say we do sleep for 7 to 8 hours in a day, that apparently becomes one third of our life, which means if you live for 90 years, 30 years will be spent to sleep, indicating that sleep is indeed important for an organism. In today's talk, I have structured it as a very general talk by including some of the major findings from the recent paper published in 2020 from or by by Raghana Raghulcha from Harvard University. Before getting into the details of the paper, let me briefly tell you about the importance of sleep. Does all animals exhibit sleep? If we consider various organisms, humans on an average sleep for 8 hours. And 8 hours of sleep is sufficient to rejuvenate humans, whereas giraffes need about 2 hours of sleep in a day, and a tiger requires close to 16 hours of sleep. Thus, although sleep structure varies across different taxa, most animals spend significant amounts of time to sleep, indicating sleep is important. Another fascinating question is why sleep evolved in humans, and we don't know yet the precise reason behind the evolution of sleep. It is believed that during the early stages of evolution, humans exhibited polyphasic sleep with the alternative periods of sleeping and waking so that they could check for the threats. But during the course of evolution, once when humans started to stay in shelters with more protection, sleep was structured and the body learned to perform functions associated with the sleep. If we consider the current situation in human populations, there are two sleep patterns, biphasic and monophasic. Biphasic sleep cycle consists of 5 to 8 hours of sleep during the night and a nap during the middle of the day. And currently we are at a point where parents forcing their children to sleep at a certain time of the day, and they are pushed away from the fragmented sleep pattern that was followed previously. However, sleep is important in humans. We do sleep, true, but why? What is the importance of sleep? That is not yet well understood. And I would like to discuss a few research experiments carried out in this aspect. In human body, or in our body, all the organs require continuous supply of nutrients to every cell present in the body. So the circulatory system solved this nutrient supply problem by sending blood vessels to each and every corner of the body. So let's consider the brain. In this particular video, it shows the blood vessels present in the brain of a living mice. As you can see, the entire brain is filled with the network of blood vessels, and the blood vessels are starting from the surface of the brain and it dives deep inside the tissues of the brain, and it ensures that nutrients and oxygen is supplied continuously to every cells present in the brain. As a byproduct of this nutrient processing, waste products are also accumulated in these cells that needs to be efficiently cleared. This is the second basic problem that every organ needs to solve. In order to efficiently clear the waste products, our body has evolved with a system, as shown in this diagram. Lymphatic system efficiently removes the waste products from the human body. And lymphatic system innervates into almost all the organs present in the body. But if you have a close look at this lymphatic system, there are no lymphatic vessels present in the brain, which is not making much sense, because brain is an intensively active organ and it produces corresponding amount of waste. So it is necessary that efficient waste clearance system is functional in the brain. Researchers addressed this question and they found that the brain fluid, the cerebrospinal fluid present in the brain, plays an important role in clearing the waste products accumulated in between the brain cells. The CSF present around the brain collects the waste products present in between the brain cells, and they are dumped along with the waste in the blood. Here in this particular video, the left panel shows the image of the brain surface of a living mice, and the right panel shows the brain or the tissues present inside the brain. And let's see how the cerebrospinal fluid is percolating into the deep inside tissues of the brain. It is present, definitely it is present on the surface of the brain, and it is pumped deep into the tissues of the brain such that it ensures efficient clearance of the protein and other waste products accumulated deep inside the brain tissue. Thus, CSF plays an important role in waste clearance inside the brain. But the surprising fact is that this CSF mediated clearance of waste material occurs only in a sleeping brain, not when an organism is awake. Let's have a look at this video. This is the image of a waking brain in a live mice, the left panel. And let's see how much CSF is present there deep inside the tissues when the organism is awake. The same brain is imaged when the organism falls asleep. And you could see a large volume of CSF is pumped deep into the tissues of the brain such that the waste removal is efficiently managed when the organism is asleep. Thus, sleep acts as an ultimate brain washer, and it rejuvenates the brain efficiently. This is one of the most important functions of the sleep. Apart from that, let's also discuss another brain-related restorative function of sleep. When an organism is involved in various activities during the wake phase, or let's consider the humans, when we are involved in various activities during the daytime, the brain neuronal signaling is intensively active, especially in the hippocampus, which is acting as the seat of memory consolidation. The neuron signaling is intensively active. The neuron-to-neuron communication is occurring via the synapse, as shown here in this picture. In the presynaptic region, there are synaptic vesicles filled with the neurotransmitters, and in the postsynaptic region, there are receptors present in order to receive the signals from the neurotransmitters. When an organism is awake, the synaptic strengthening occurs. Synaptic strengthening is the process in which more and more synaptic vesicles are released from the presynaptic region, and as a result, more and more receptors are expressed in the postsynaptic region. This leads to synaptic strengthening during the daytime when an organism is awake. Whereas when an organism is asleep, there is a survey going on during which the synaptic connections are surveyed efficiently, and some of the weaker connections are eliminated. Some of the neuronal connections are eliminated, some connections are strengthened, during which the memory consolidation occurs, and some connections returns to the baseline with the adequate number of receptors and synaptic vesicles. Thus, sleep plays an important role in maintaining the neuronal synaptic strength. It also plays an important role in neuronal development and for the development of new neuronal connections. These are the two major brain-related restorative functions of sleep. One is that sleep acts as an ultimate brain washer, thus it restores the function of brain. Apart from that, it also maintains the synaptic connections with adequate synaptic strength, and it helps to develop new neuronal connections. In addition to these functions like immunity, cognition, metabolism are sleep dependent. Sleep deprivation, for example, sleep deprivation may lead to dysfunction of various systems, like it may alter the function of nervous system. It can have an impact on the gastrointestinal, cardiac, metabolic, immunological system. And numerous clinical studies and experimental studies showed that sleep deprivation is associated with serious health problems. And sleep deprivation can lead to premature lethality. However, the exact cause of the sleep deprivation mediated lethality is not yet well understood. This sleep deprivation mediated lethality could be either due to the secondary consequence of altered nervous system function, or it could be a direct effect of sleep deprivation. We don't know this. Hence, it is important to understand whether a single system is responsible for the sleep deprivation mediated lethality. If we rescue a single system, whether it could prevent the sleep deprivation mediated lethality is important. Thus, preventing the lethality via a single means will help us to understand whether that single system is affecting rest of the systems present in the body, which leads to lethality in humans. A paper based on mammalian system mice and flies showed that, this paper was published in 2020, and this paper showed that sleep deprivation can lead to accumulation of reactive oxygen species, specifically in the gut. And this accumulation of reactive oxygen species is not a mere correlates with the sleep deprivation. It indeed acts as a driver for the lethality associated with the sleep deprivation. We will be discussing the major findings from this paper. In this particular paper, they have used a genetic tool in Drosophila for the targeted expression of the gene of interest. This genetic tool consists of two components, UAS and GAL4. UAS-GAL4 system consists of a GAL4 gene that encodes the yeast transcription activator protein. This is present in a parental fly, and as a second component, the upstream activation sequence is present in the other parental fly. The GAL4 is fused with a tissue-specific promoter, and the UAS sequence is fused with the gene of interest, or the RNAi of the gene that we are interested in. When we cross the GAL4 line with the UAS line, in the F1 progeny, GAL4 protein binds to the upstream activation sequence, and it will either overexpress the gene of interest or it will overexpress the RNAi of the gene of interest. This particular genetic tool was used in the study. And in order to address the role of sleep deprivation in survival, they also looked for approaches that can induce sleep deprivation in Drosophila for a long period of time. For that, they have used UAS GAL4 system. They used two GAL4 lines, as shown here. I'm not naming the GAL4 here. Let's call it as experimental line 1, which is specific to the sleep-preventing neurons present in the brain. And we have another GAL4 line that is also specific to the sleep-preventing neurons present in the brain. And these two GAL4 lines are crossed with a UAS line in which TRPA1 channel is attached. TRPA1 is a cation channel, and this is a heat-sensitive ion channel. So when we cross the GAL4 line with the TRPA1 UAS line, At 21 degrees Celsius, TRIP A1 channel remains closed. Whereas if we transfer the flies to a higher temperature at 29 degrees Celsius, the TRIP A1 channels are activated and the sleep preventing neurons are activated in the fly brain. So let's consider what is the effect of this experiment if we activate the neurons, sleep preventing neurons present in the fly brain via the TRIP A1 channels. This particular figure shows the sleep profile of flies under 12-hour light, 12-hour dark cycles, and 5 minutes of immobility is plotted here as sleep. The gray and black lines represent the UAS and GAL4 control, and we can see here both the controls exhibit enhanced sleep during the middle of the day and they consolidate their sleep during the night. At 21 degrees Celsius, even the experimental line 1, which is represented here in green color, they exhibit a sleep pattern which is more or less similar to that of the controls. They do exhibit enhanced sleep during the middle of the day and they consolidate the sleep during the night. But when these flies are transferred to higher temperature at 29 degrees Celsius, the experimental fly lines, in these experimental fly lines, sleep preventing neurons are activated, hence they do suppress the sleep. Even during second day, they do exhibit a significant reduction in sleep compared to both the controls. This is the case of experimental line 1, and this total sleep is quantified here, and we can see that the experimental fly lines exhibit reduced sleep compared to both the controls. Similarly, in the experiment line 2 as well, we could see that at 21 degrees Celsius, the experimental fly lines behaves more or less similar to that of the control, whereas at 29 degrees Celsius, they suppress their sleep as a result of the activation of the sleep preventing neurons. The total sleep is quantified here and the experimental fly lines exhibit a significant reduction in total sleep compared controls. Good enough. And the sleep. They also tested what is its effect on survivorship. Here in this particular plot, they have plotted the survivorship at 29 degrees Celsius because they have thermogenetically activated the sleep suppressing neurons. Blue and green are the experimental fly lines from here onwards. We could see that there is a significant reduction in the survivorship in the experimental fly lines compared to both the controls. And the marked decrease in survivorship is evident from 10th day of sleep deprivation. Hence, they asked, what if we stop sleep deprivation on 10th day and allow the flies to sleep as usual, and they looked at they assessed the recovery sleep on day 1 up to day 15th, and it was found that on 15th day these flies have recovered the sleep and they do sleep similar to that of controls. This is true in the case of both the experimental lines. After the sleep recovery, they have achieved the proper sleep pattern, and it was also noted that if flies are provided with proper adequate sleep after 10 days of sleep deprivation, they rescue the survival phenotype and they survive as long as the controls are shown here in this figure. This result suggests that thermogenetic sleep deprivation shortens the lifespan in flies, and it could have some other impact in the system of the fly. This is what they tested. Here, this particular graph shows that the survivorship reduces in the experimental fly lines after 10 days of sleep deprivation. Hence, rest of the experiments were conducted on day 10 of sleep deprivation. They have dissected the fly and looked at various organs in the fly to understand what is the effect of sleep deprivation in various organs of the fly. Here, the middle panel represents the experimental line 1 and the bottom panel represents the experimental line 2, which are thermogenetically sleep deprived. Rest of the panels are experimental lines. And in most of the tissue, there are no distinguishable differences between the control and experimental fly lines, except the gut. We could see that there is a significant increase in the reactive oxygen species, or henceforth referred as ROS. ROS is increased in both the experimental line 1 and in experimental line 2 in the gut, which is quantified here in this particular graph. I hope you can see the graphs here. Here it shows that as a result of the sleep deprivation, there is a significant increase. Can you all see my screen?
Yeah, we can see your screen, but the desktop is visible.
Oh, okay. Can I just figure it out what happened? Give me a minute.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, now the slides are visible.
It's visible, right? Yeah. My concern was that this left panel graph, can you see the labels of the left panel graph?
Yeah, we can see almost all the labels, but like there's a mate is sharing your screen notification, right? If you hide that, we'll be able to see that.
Let me explain it. The last bar, this is the label for this last bar is gut. So here, this graph shows that as a result of the sleep deprivation, there is a significant increase in the ROS level accumulated in the gut in both experimental line 1 and experimental line 2. I'm sorry that you cannot see the experimental line 1 result, but it is indeed true. Okay. Followed by that, they also tested if we provide recovery sleep after 10 days of sleep deprivation, what will happen to the accumulated ROS level? Will it return to the baseline level? So here in this particular panel, the upper panel shows that during thermogenetic sleep deprivation, there is a progressive accumulation of ROS in the gut. Followed by that, if we provide recovery sleep, on fifth day of sleep recovery, there is no significant reduction in the ROS level. But on 15th day, the ROS level decreases to the baseline. This is quantified here at the bottom panel. After 10 days of sleep deprivation, there is a significant increase in the ROS level in the gut. And as the recovery sleep progresses on day 15, the ROS level returns to the baseline level. This is the case of experimental line 1. Even for experimental line 2, we can see that as a result of the sleep deprivation, there is an increase in the ROS level on 10th day. Followed by that, during recovery sleep on 15th day, the ROS level reduces to the baseline. That is quantified here, which is clear. So apart from thermogenetic sleep deprivation, they also tested the effect of other sleep deprivation methods on ROS accumulation in the gut. Other than thermogenetic sleep deprivation, mechanical deprivation is one of the most commonly used approach for sleep deprivation. And here we can see that compared to the undisturbed control, mechanical vibrations leads to decreased sleep in wild-type flies. They also tested what is the effect of this mechanical sleep deprivation on gut ROS level, and it was found that Mechanical sleep deprivation leads to enhanced ROS level in the gut, which is quantified here in the right side panel. In the third approach, they used mutants against the sleep regulators, such as sleepless and insomniac. Sleepless and insomniac gene encodes the protein that acts as the sleep promoting molecules. And mutation on sleepless gene leads to decreased sleep in flies compared to the wild type controlled flies. Similarly, mutation on insomniac gene leads to a significant reduction in total sleep compared to the controls. In this particular study, they tested what is the effect of this sleep loss in these mutants, or they tested whether sleep deprivation in these mutants would lead to enhanced ROS accumulation. And the results showed that in sleepless mutant, there is an enhanced ROS level present in the gut compared to the control, that is quantified here in the right side panel. Consistently, in the case of insomnia flies, they also possess an enhanced ROS level in the gut compared to the control, as quantified here in the right side panel. So, while considering all these three approaches, the results suggest that thermogenetic sleep deprivation, mechanical sleep deprivation, and genetic sleep deprivation could lead to accumulation of reactive oxygen species in the gut of Drosophila. Further, they studied what is the further consequence of ROS level accumulated in the gut. It is already known that ROS can oxidize the cellular macromolecules present in the body. They were interested to understand whether the ROS accumulated in the gut would lead to oxidative stress in the gut. After 10 days of sleep deprivation, they assessed the markers of lysosome, the organ which is involved in degrading the damaged cell components, the cell death markers such as apoptosis and necrosis markers, they assessed. They assessed this oxidative stress markers in the controls in experimental light 1 and in experimental light 2 as shown here. And they found that in both experimental line 1 and in experimental line 2, these are thermogenetically sleep deprived flies. In this particular experiment, they have used thermogenetic sleep deprivation in which they activate the sleep preventing neurons present in the brain. And they found that as a result of thermogenetic sleep deprivation, DNA damage associated markers are enhanced in the gut. In addition, stress granules level is enhanced. There is an increase in the level of lysosome, and there is an increase in the apoptosis and necrosis markers throughout the gut in the case of both experimental line 1 and experimental line 2. The same is quantified here. For example, DNA damage markers are quantified here, and it is shown that in the case of experimental line 1 and 2, there is a significant increase in the markers associated with the DNA damage. Similarly, in these two experimental lines, there is a significant increase in the stress granules, in the number of lysosomes, in the case of markers associated with apoptosis and necrosis. So far studies were conducted in Drosophila, and the results showed that as a result of various modes of sleep deprivation, ROS level increases in the gut, and it leads to oxidative stress in the gut of Drosophila. This particular study is conducted in mammals. In mice, sleep deprivation was provided for day 1, day 2, and it was provided for 5 days, and they assessed the effect of the sleep deprivation in various tissues of the body in the mice. In most of the tissues, there is no distinguishable differences in the case of non-sleep deprived animals and sleep deprived animals. However, only in small intestine and in large intestine, there is an increase in the ROS levels in the case of sleep deprived animals. As you can see here, there is a significant increase in the ROS level in small intestine and in large intestine, which is quantified here in this particular graph. As you can see here, as the number of days of sleep deprivation increases, there is a significant increase in the ROS level in both large intestine and in the small intestine. They also tested whether this increased ROS level is associated with oxidative stress in the small intestine and large intestine of mice. They assessed the markers associated with DNA damage, stress granules, and apoptosis. It was found that after 2 days of sleep deprivation, there is no significant change in the markers associated with the oxidative stress. But after 5 days of sleep deprivation, we could see that there is a significant increase in the markers associated with DNA damage, stress granules, and apoptosis in both small intestine and in large intestine. These are the experiments carried out in mice, and the results showed that even in mammalian system, sleep deprivation can lead to accumulation of ROS in the gut, and that can lead to oxidative stress in the gut. From here onwards, rest of the experiments are conducted in Drosophila itself. Here, they have used thermogenetic sleep deprivation in all the experiments. In the left panel, it shows the survivorship of flies in which sleep is deprived thermogenetically. The green line indicates the survivorship of flies which is sleep deprived thermogenetically. And they were interested to understand what would be the effect of a compound that is introduced orally via food into this particular fly. What would be the effect on ROS level? Will it rescue the survivorship phenotype? I hope it's clear. These flies were thermogenetically sleep deprived, and the thermogenetically sleep deprived flies were provided with the compounds such as melatonin, lipoic acid, and NAD via food. And they were interested to understand these compounds will neutralize the ROS present in the gut, and will it rescue the survival phenotype? And it was found that as a result of the treatment with these compounds, the survivorship phenotype is rescued in these flies. The flies which were treated with the compounds, they lived as long as the control flies which are not sleep deprived. This is the case of experimental line 1. Similar experiments were conducted in the case of experimental line 2, where they were thermogenetically sleep deprived, and when they were provided with the compounds that neutralizes the ROS accumulated in the gut, that led to rescued the survivorship of the flies. They also tested whether the treatment with the melatonin, lipoic acid, and NAD would reduce the ROS level accumulated in the gut in the case of experimental line 1 and experimental line 2, which are thermogenetically sleep deprived. And the results showed that indeed the treatment with melatonin, lipoic acid, and NAD indeed reduces the ROS level accumulated in the gut as a result of the sleep deprivation. Please note that these flies are sleep deprived. Still, the treatment with melatonin, lipoic acid, and NAD could reduce the level of ROS accumulated in the gut. The same information is given here in the quantified graph. It shows that as a result of the various compound treatment, the ROS level accumulated in the gut is reduced in both experimental line 1 and 2. One drawback of the study is that the ROS neutralizing compounds were provided via food or it was provided orally. Hence, it is likely that these compounds are present in the gut, but there are chances that this compound may get accumulated in other organs as well. It can have a protective effect or it can have an impact on the survivorship. Hence, they wanted to come up with an experiment where they could more specifically target the expression of antioxidative enzymes only in the gut. To achieve that, they have used two transgenic expression systems. One is that they have used UAS Gal4 system. Along with that, they used Lexa-Lexa-OP system. Lexa-Lexa-OP system operates in a similar manner that was explained for UAS Gal4 system. So in this particular experiment, they have used both UAS Gal4 system and Lexa-Lexa-OP system. The objective of this experiment is that they want to thermogenetically sleep deprive the flies by activating the sleep preventing neurons in the fly brain. For that, they have used Lexa-Lexa-OP system through which they have activated the sleep preventing neurons. They have expressed TRPA1 ion channels in the sleep preventing neurons with the help of Lexa-Lexa-OP system, and it was found that at 21 degrees Celsius, the experimental fly lines shown here in red light behaves as similar as the control. Whereas when these flies were transferred to 29 degrees Celsius, the sleep preventing neurons are activated. As a result, these flies suppresses their sleep and there is a significant reduction in the total sleep as shown here in the quantified graph. Along with this Lexa-Lexa-OP system in which sleep is thermogenetically deprived in the flies, they also incorporated a UAS Gal4 system which is specific to the gut. They have used MEX1 Gal4 which is specific to the gut so that they could overexpress the antioxidative enzymes here to scavenge the ROS present or ROS accumulated in the gut. So this is the combined form of Lexa system and UAS Gal4 system. Lexa is specific to the sleep preventing neurons and Gal4 system is specifically targeting the gut tissues which has accumulated the ROS. And let's look at the result, what is going on once when we thermogenetically sleep deprive the flies, and in addition we are overexpressing the antioxidative enzymes in the gut. Here the black and gray are the controls in which there is no thermogenetic sleep deprivation, there is no overexpression of antioxidative enzymes, and the survivorship plot shows that at 29 degrees Celsius the control flies, they survives for around 30 to 40 days. When we thermogenetically sleep deprive the flies, those flies are surviving shorter compared to the controls. Now, in the same set of flies which are thermogenetically sleep deprived, we are overexpressing the antioxidative enzymes specifically in the gut. And we could see that as a result of the overexpression of antioxidative enzymes such as superoxide dismutase 1, SOD1, SOD2 and catalase, that rescues the survival phenotype. These flies are surviving as long as the control, which does not experience any sleep deprivation, and this is also shown in the survivorship plot. You can see that these are the flies which is thermogenetically sleep deprived. In the same flies, we do overexpress the antioxidative enzymes in the gut that rescues the survival phenotype, and they survive as long as the controls. They also tested what is the effect of this overexpressing antioxidative enzymes in the gut on the ROS level. Here, they tested the level of rows, the markers associated with DNA damage, and the markers associated with apoptosis. In the case of non-sleep deprived flies, in the case of sleep deprived flies, and in the case of sleep deprived flies in which SOD, the antioxidative enzyme, is overexpressed. And the results showed that in the non-deprived flies, there is no ROS accumulated, there is no markers, there is no increase in the markers associated with DNA damage and apoptosis. Whereas in the case of sleep-deprived flies, there is an enhanced level of ROS in the gut. In addition, the markers of DNA damage and apoptosis is increased. As a result of the overexpression of the antioxidative enzymes in the gut, ROS level is decreased to the baseline level, and the oxidative stress markers are also decreased in the flies overexpressing antioxidative enzymes in the gut. Based on these results, we could conclude that thermogenetic mechanical sleep deprivation and genetic sleep deprivation leads to the accumulation of ROS in the gut, and overexpressing antioxidative enzymes in sleep-deprived flies in the gut could rescue the lethality. Based on these results, let's summarize the findings as follows. Sleep deprivation in both mice and Drosophila leads to accumulation of reactive oxygen species in the gut. Only in Drosophila, it leads to premature death. The results also showed that antioxidative enzymes present in the gut could prevent the accumulation of reactive oxygen species, and it could protect the flies from sleep deprivation mediated lethality. However, I would say those who are sleep deprived, instead of taking the antioxidants, it would be better to follow the sleep duration recommendations released by National Sleep Foundation. According to National Sleep Foundation, depending on the age group, individuals requires specific duration of sleep. For example, in the case of newborn, they have irregular sleep pattern, whereas after 3 months, in infants, they start to consolidate their sleep as the circadian clock develops in them, and they consolidate their sleep for longer duration. In children, they do sleep for consolidated hours during the night time. Apart from that, they have daytime naps, 1 or 2 daytime naps. In young adults, like most of the audience present here, young adults require 7 to 9 hours of sleep, and in older adults, there is a marked decrease in sleep that is associated with the deterioration of the biological clocks in older people. Hence, I would suggest to follow the sleep duration recommendation instead of being sleep deprived and depending on the antioxidative enzymes. With this, I would like to stop here and thank you. I would be happy to take questions.
Hello? Ma'am?
Can you hear me?
Ah, yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, aren't the older people are needed to sleep more because they are a little weak compared to younger ones?
Yes, Varun, your question is interesting, whether older people want to sleep more, right?
Yes.
To meet their physiological needs. That is true. But if we consider their sleep or the mechanisms that regulate sleep, sleep is regulated via 2 pathways. One is homeostatic regulation, the other one is circadian clock mediated regulation. Circadian clock regulates the level of melatonin, which is a sleep hormone, sleep promoting hormone. Melatonin level decreases in older adults. As a result of that, their sleep duration is decreased.
Okay, ma'am.
That is one reason. Apart from that, clock, circadian clock drives the oscillation of clock proteins. The amplitude of the clock gene oscillation is dampened in older adults. That is another reason for fragmented sleep in them. I hope I answered your question, Varun.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah, I had a question. Like, when initially when you showed the charts of like different animals and their sleep durations, so what is the cause of the different sleep durations? Like, there's no dependence on body mass or something, that like there was no clear indication of what is the reason behind it.
That's an interesting question, Ravi. There are multiple studies focusing on that, whether there is any correlation. There are a couple of studies in with small body size, they tend to sleep more compared to with larger body weight. There is another study in which they addressed whether carnivores and herbivores that study showed that probably herbivores would sleep less because they have to escape from the predators, hence they spend lesser time for sleep, whereas carnivores, they do sleep more. For example, tiger, it sleeps for 16 hours in a day, whereas herbivores, they sleep less. There are a couple of studies addressing this question. Did I answer your question or do you have any?
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Yeah, so if anyone has any questions, you can unmute yourself and ask.
I have a question.
Yes,
Suresh, please. Yeah, so I think this question partially asked by the previous person. Okay. You said different animals have different sleep duration. For example, giraffe has 1.9 hours a day.
Right.
So is there a special biological pathway by which they can quench the ROS or other waste produced for them? Is it special than other organisms which require higher duration of sleep?
Okay, so let me answer this question this way. Sleep is regulated by our two pathways. One is circadian clock mediated regulation, the other one is homeostatic regulation.
Okay.
Homeostatic regulation implies the duration, how much time an individual should sleep. In different organs, sleeps for 2 hours, whereas the tiger sleeps for 6 hours. Okay. At one point, homeostatic regulation of sleep. One important molecule associated with the homeostatic regulation of adenosine level. There are other molecules involved in homeostatic regulation of sleep. The level of such regulators vary between difference in the duration of the sleep.
Can I ask one more question? So in the Drosophila study, in the fly study, did they study the longevity of this sleep deprived flies to directly correlate sleep deprivation versus the longevity? Your title said that it's important for life, right?
Wherever I talked about the survivorship, that shows the longevity, like span data.
Okay. Yeah, I missed a part of the talk because I couldn't call actually, so maybe I missed something.
Right. Yeah, in the initial experiment itself, they assessed the effect of sleep between people or survivors, or they assessed the lifespan. And they found that there is a significant increase in the lifespan as a result of
it. Okay. I have one more last question. Sure. So you said that you said there is some fluid, again I forgot the name of the fluid, which clears the debris from neurons, right? Brains. Yes. What about the other cells like pneumocells, cardiocytes, hepatocytes, myocytes, etc.? Do they have such mechanism to clear such debris?
In those tissues, there is lymphatic system function.
Products
accumulated in other tissues. Okay, I understand. Thanks. Yes, Sharon. There is no clear-cut evidence on that, Sharon. What is known is during the sleep phase, the neurons shrink because synaptic strength is decreasing during the night time. Hence, the CSF percolates even better in between the brain cells. This is what is known. We don't know whether there is any difference in the CSF composition itself when an organism is asleep and awake. The only information I can give is the CSF present in the brain when an organism is asleep, when it consists of more harmful substances because it is removing the harmful or the waste products present in between the brain cells. Yeah.
Ma'am?
Yes.
I have a question.
Sharanya?
Yes, ma'am. What are the effects of sleeping too much?
That's a good question. So, adequate sleep is always good.
Okay.
But excess sleep can have adverse effect. For example, circadian clock is regulating various biological processes to occur at the appropriate time of the day. In that schedule, sleep is scheduled for an appropriate duration. If it exceeds beyond that adequate time, that balance between various physiological, metabolic, and behavioral processes will be disrupted. Hence, it is always better to sleep for adequate duration instead of excess sleep.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. Are there any other questions? Sharak and Ravi, I think there are.
Yeah. I hope there are no more questions. And most of the people, I think, they left by now. So thank you, ma'am, for presenting this talk and letting out your time on the busy schedule. It was a nice talk and it was very informative for us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you everyone for attending this talk also.
Thanks.